Hi, welcome back to part two, the next year. So just a recap of where we were for a couple of slides here. At the end of the previous year in this example, we had reduced our income by the after-tax unrealized profit of $360 on the income statement. On the balance sheet, we reduced inventory by $600 and we set up a deferred tax asset of $240. So here's what that amounted to. Remember that income accounts are temporary accounts and they roll up into retained earnings. So the 360 reduction of income in 20X1 actually caused retained earnings on a consolidated basis to be 360 less. And on the asset side, that's balanced by minus 600 in ending inventory, but the creation of a deferred tax asset at 240 for total reduction to 360. So this kind of balances out our balance sheet with those two reductions. Now we're going to move to the next year and look at what happens when that inventory is sold. Now in this course, the assumption will always be that if you have intercompany sales of inventory in ending inventory, it is sold the next year. If it was not sold the next year, that would be like not selling anything from our beginning inventory, which would mean we actually had an impairment more than anything. So that's the assumption. So this merchandise is in our beginning inventory and it is sold in year two. Now in our example, year two is 20X2. So here are the income statement adjustments that we're going to do. This $600 is now realized. Note that, again, we're going to use cost of goods sold to make this adjustment. What we want to do is add the profit. So cost of goods sold is essentially an expense account. If we take 600 away from it, we're actually adding income. The other adjustment on your income statement is to add $240 to your tax expense. And this matches tax expense this year to the year in which we recognize the $600 of profit. So the effect on your income statement is twofold. One, cost of goods sold minus 600, this increases income. Tax expense plus 240, this reduces income. The net effect is to increase income by 360. And note that this is basically just the same number as last year. Last year we reduced income by 360 because it was not earned by the consolidated entity. This year we increase the 360 because it is earned. So those are the income statement adjustments. Now, let's look at the balance sheet. And it really does get easy. Because remember, on your balance sheet, you are reporting ending inventory. So we're looking at the end of 20X2. All of that beginning inventory is gone. We're just looking at the parent plus subsidiary ending inventory. So unless you have had further unrealized intercompany inventory sales in ending inventory, except for that, leave it alone. So basically, there is no adjustment for this initial $600. Now, the same thing happens for your deferred tax asset. Last year on your balance sheet, it was $240, but we don't have it anymore. We don't have it because we essentially transferred it to this year's tax expense. So your deferred tax asset is used up, and because it's gone, we just don't put it on the balance sheet. So as you can see, the balance sheet adjustments are really easy. You just don't have any. They all take care of themselves. Now, when you actually go to do the calculation, you're going to do calculations in step 5, which is calculation of consolidated net income. You're going to have to actually take that $360 after-tax profit and add it to the subsidiary income. Remember, it was the subsidiary that made the original sale. So last year, we deducted this from the subsidiary income. This year, since it's earned, we added. So that's the adjustment in step five. So you'll notice that throughout this video and the previous one, we're using cost of goods sold to adjust our income for a reduction for unrealized profit and an addition to income for realized profit. So the next quick little example is going to show you the calculation of cost of goods sold, and let's just call it the worst case scenario. How many adjustments can you possibly have for cost of goods sold? So here is as bad as it can get. And at the end of this, what I would like is I would like you to calculate cost of goods sold for your consolidated income statement. So we have intercompany sales, and in the previous video, you learned what to do with those. These are the two cost of goods sold numbers from your individual company financial statements. We had realized profit on downstream sales, realized profit on upstream sales, and that was last year's unrealized. And then we also, in the current year, have unrealized profit on current year downstream sales and unrealized profit on current year upstream sales. So this represents every possible change to cost of goods sold. And what you should be able to do on any consolidation is get this right. And I'm going to give you a little extra information on how consolidations are marked on a final examination. Normally, every change you make to an income statement item is worth one mark. Now, this is a big example because we've got a lot going on, but here we have the beginning numbers. You don't get any marks for writing down the parent number and the sub number from their own individual income statements. This would be a mark, this would be a mark, as would this, this, and this. So the cost of goods sold on your income statement on a final exam, if it were this question, would be worth 5 marks. To get those marks, you not only have to remember to put the number in, you have to get the sign right. So it's really important that you understand what's going on. Don't just try and memorize it. If you have realized profit, you want to increase your net income. How do you increase your net income if you're adjusting an expense account? Well, you reduce the expense account. So pause the video here, and I would like you to calculate cost of goods sold on your consolidated income statement. Okay, here it is. Parent plus sub from the individual statements minus intercompany sales in total minus realized sales from the parent to the sub, minus realized profit from the sub to the parent, add unrealized profit downstream, add unrealized profit upstream. Now, this is why I do my realized profit first when I calculate this, because the first thing we do is minus intercompany sales. And I get going with the minus signs here. Minus 40,000 and minus 25,000 represents our realized profit. We're reducing our expense, which is adding to income, which is allowing us to realize the profit. Then I save my adds for the end, and this is my unrealized profit. I'm adding to my expense, therefore decreasing income. Hope you did that right. Here's the final number.